Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Murder in a Cup by Lauren Elliott. Narrated by Stephanie Richardson. Chapter 1. We all have our small daily rituals. They range from a must-have, take-on-the-go morning cup of coffee or tea to double or even triple-checking the front door to make certain it's locked behind us. However, whether we recognize them as rituals is another thing. For Shaylee Myers, certainly no workday could commence without her spending quiet time in the second-floor greenhouse of Crystals and Curiosities, her tea shop in Bray Harbor, California. Although, if you referred to this part of her morning routine as a ritual, she would totally dismiss it and tell you she just enjoyed the peace and quiet before she started another busy day peopling. She would climb the spiral wrought iron staircase to the second floor, pause at the top in the entrance to the small alcove office, and immediately close her eyes. This part, blocking out the sight of all the paperwork that screamed at her daily from the desk, was a must. Then she'd reach around behind her with her left hand and grip the handrail to keep her bearings. Stumbling blindly down the staircase was not her idea of the perfect start to any day. She'd draw in a deep breath, and because she had done this every workday morning for the past year, she would take exactly 4 steps to her left until she was well past the handrail and steep stairs it surrounded. And then she'd slowly blow out that initial cleansing breath. After that, she'd slowly inhale another deep breath and savor the pungent, earthy scents of recently watered soil and the accompanying spring-like fragrance of the plants and herbs growing in the planter boxes that filled her second-floor conservatory. Next, she'd open her eyes, smile at the vast array of greenery that surrounded her, and take a seat on the bench beside the potting table where she would sit for precisely 30 minutes to reflect on and give thanks to all in her life that had brought her to this moment in time. On occasion, her tranquility would be threatened. It would start with a churning in the pit of her stomach, and fleeting images would pop into her mind of her cheating, thieving ex-husband who had ruined her career and her reputation back in Santa Fe, New Mexico. She'd quickly draw another deep breath, releasing it along with her pent-up anger toward him. Then remind herself that sometimes when things fall apart, better things fall into place, and if Brad hadn't done what he had, she might well not be sitting here today. She would then give thanks, not only to him for his infidelity and scheming behind her back, but to Bridget Early, the woman who by her bequeathment had led her here and given her this new lease on life. The mother Shaylee would never get to know, except through the journals and letters she'd come across living in Bridget's cottage and running Bridget's tea shop. Without fail, tears would well up in her eyes. Yes, this tea shop had been a new beginning and had led Shay down a path she never thought or knew existed, but it hadn't been an easy road. Far from it. It had tested her resilience this past year for certain. The warming of the amulet under her blouse against her chest was a constant reminder of the powers it awakened in her, not to mention the confusion that followed on the rare occasion she had opened not only the pouch encasing the amulet, but also the door that, by doing so, opened up in her mind. On that reflection, a shiver would race up her spine and settle at the base of her skull. Yearning to speak with Bridget, not only in spirit, but in body, with tear-filled eyes, she'd once again scan the opulent greenery that surrounded her. There were still too many unanswered questions, and she had no idea where the answers lay. Like clockwork, she'd hear the reverberating ping of footsteps on metal. She would hurriedly wipe her damp cheeks and then hear her sister Jen asking in a cheery voice, "Shay, are you up here?" as she reached the top of the stairs and came around into the greenhouse. "I can't believe you always manage to beat me in. Here's your morning coffee," Jen would say. And given the day, her blonde hair might be a single long braid that hung down her chest, giving her the appearance of a Norwegian Viking queen. Or it might be tucked up in a high ponytail like the cheerleader she had been back in high school. She never knew what version of her sister she would encounter, but it didn't matter because every version of her sister reminded her why she loved being back in Bray Harbor. After a 16-year absence, it meant she was reunited with the only remaining family member she had in the world. Then Jen would take a seat on the bench beside Shay. Her forget-me-not pale blue eyes would sparkle as she'd say, "I just love that we take a few minutes every morning to sit and drink in all this." Jen would then wave her hand toward the expanse of the greenhouse. "But best of all, I'm glad we still have our morning coffee before a day of tea services." Then she'd giggle at their naughtiness and take a sip from her steaming takeout cup from the coffee shop across the street. Shay would nod and smile, then take a sip from her cup and silently give thanks for the opportunity to work side by side with the person she loved most in this world. Even though she'd never had the heart to tell her sister that she purposely arrived 30 minutes before their prearranged meeting time, just so she could have all this to herself while she had her morning chat with Bridget. No, this wasn't just a daily routine or even a ritual. It was Shay's way of keeping in touch with her new life and the new her. It was a time to quiet and separate her erratic thoughts from her heightened senses, the ones that meant she could sense other people's energy. Inky feelings is what her sister called them, and Shay would smile with Jen's description. But most important to her, no matter what they were called, was that they had served her throughout her life. Even though there was still so much about her abilities she didn't understand, she hoped this part of her morning routine would bring a kind of enlightenment to her, because the secret to harnessing her power was here, somewhere. She was sure of it. Why else would Bridget, the mother she never knew, have left all this to her if not to teach her? However, today, something was off. There was a disturbance, an unusual static buzzing in the air, disrupting the greenhouse's usual reassuring setting. When the static level increased and found a home at the base of Shay's skull, she tilted her head, much like Spirit, the dog who had claimed her, did when he sensed something. No matter how she positioned her head, she couldn't detect the origins of the odd sensation prickling her skin. Instinctively, Shay reached over and gently squeezed her sister's hand in hers. "What brought that on?" Jen turned to her, a puzzled expression on her face. "Just because." Shay shrugged and weakly smiled. "Aw, sis, are you having one of those moments again? You've been thinking about Bridget, haven't you?" Jen gently cupped Shay's cheek in her hand. "You know that just because we discovered we aren't related by blood, it doesn't mean our bond isn't strong, right? Because I've told you 1,000 times this past year that the lifetime bond we have can never be broken, as it goes deeper than blood ties ever could." Shay shook her head. "No, it's not that. Something in the air is off, and I can't quite put my finger on it." She took another sip of her morning elixir, but instead of a sense of contentment rushing through her, a shiver tingled across her shoulders. She scanned the rows and rows of waist-high planter tables veiled with pots of flourishing vegetation that grew like weeds at the protection and warmth of the greenhouse. Whatever was wrong was here, in front of her somewhere in all this greenery. Her overall sense of uneasiness narrowed in on the closest table, and the amulet in the leather pouch she wore around her neck, tucked discreetly under her blouse, grew warm against her skin. She rose to her feet and took a step toward the planter. However, in that moment, Spirit, her pure white German shepherd companion, skulked around the end of the staircase rail, crept over to the same stand Shay was eyeing, sat back on his haunches, and let out a low, woeful howl. "Did you let Spirit into the shop when you came in?" "No," said Jen, rising to her feet. "Didn't he come in with you?" "No, he didn't. After I let him out of the cottage this morning, he took off down the boardwalk." "Well," Jen gulped, "someone let him in." "Did you lock the door behind you?"
"Of course I did."
"I know he's smart, but..." Shay cocked her eyebrow at Spirit, who looked at her with puppy dog eyes. He doesn't have a key. This is no time for jokes, said Jen, choking out her words. Someone let him in, and no one other than us is supposed to be here now. On tiptoes, she unsteadily crept to the top of the railing, peered down at the main floor of the shop, and cocked her hand to her ear. I can hear someone moving around, she hoarsely whispered. It must be Tassie, Shay said, coming to her side. It can't be. It's nearly 9. She'd be in class by now. Tassie, is that you? Shay called. I tell you, it's not her because it's not a school holiday. What? Shay's young part-time assistant's voice echoed up the staircase. See, I told you, Tassie, said Shay. I sure hope her Aunt Jo didn't see her come in. We'll never hear the end of it if she skipped school to come into work, snapped Jen, and then added as she trotted down the steps. Something must be wrong. Shay glanced back at Spirit, still beside the planter table. When he lay down and whimpered, a cold hand gripped her chest. Yes, whispered Shay. Something's wrong for sure. It was clear that Spirit sensed the same shifting energy in the air, but what wasn't clear was why he had singled out that particular planter table today. It had been months since Madame Malvina, the owner of Mystical Gardens in Monterey, had swept through the greenhouse like the whirlwind that she was, pointing out several questionable plants Bridget had used in her healing treatments. Then she'd casually strolled out of the conservatory with a goodbye warning to Shay, declaring that although parts of the herbs and plants she had pointed out had healing properties if harvested and used correctly, the subsequent dried tea made from them in the hands of a novice could also be deadly. Since Shay considered herself just that when it came to the healing properties of plants, naturally Shay had panicked at the woman's parting words. Wanting to take no chances, she had immediately set about separating the questionable plants from the ones she knew she could safely use without inadvertently poisoning any of her customers. Then, to be extra safe, she had cordoned off the entire table and placed a warning sign on it. Caution, poison. And called Dr. Mia Harper, an area botanist, with an urgent plea for assistance. Shay had met her last year by way of an introduction through her old friend, Dr. Adam Ward, the local coroner, the day he'd announced to Shay that he and Mia were soon to be married. Since Mia had made it clear from the first introduction that she was itching to go through the greenhouse, she'd jumped at Shay's invitation. Mia's years of experience as a college professor had showed in her ability to explain, in layman's terms, the properties of the plants in question. She'd even offered Shay some of the textbooks used in her classes so that Shay could do some extra reading. Shay had then spent the better part of most days reading everything she could about her plants and what parts were safe to use and what she should discard. Some, like tansy, with its fragrant ferny leaves and bright yellow flowers, could be safely used in small amounts as an external wash or poultice for sprains and bruises. However, ingesting it in large amounts could be deadly, as the essential oil in the plant was toxic. Others, like cinnamon, jasmine, fennel, clover, lemongrass, and rose hips, were safe, and these plants, or parts of them, could be extracted and dried for tea. On the other hand, nutmeg was great for cooking and baking, but it could be deadly when brewed in a tea. The never-ending lists of the plants whose stems or flowers were safe but whose leaves and berries were poisonous or vice versa had caused Shay's confidence level to plummet. The more she read, the greater her doubts grew in her abilities to distinguish between what was safe and what wasn't, and she'd expressed her hesitancy to Mia. Mia had completely understood and suggested that once she got settled into this new school year and had time to screen her graduate students for the brightest and best, she would have them remove any of the plants Shay wanted to donate to the college's botany program. Shay had been thrilled, as her biggest fear was that she might accidentally poison either herself or an unsuspecting customer.
Shay?
Jen's shrill voice rang up the stairwell, pulling Shay back to the present.
I think you better come down here now.
Did you hear that, boy? We're needed downstairs. Spirit raised his head but didn't move. She had learned long ago that he also had an uncanny sense, and she shouldn't question him or his actions. If he felt the need to stand guard by the poison table, she'd let him be. At least until she knew what was going on with Tassie. Okay, you win. But I will admit you're kind of freaking me out this morning. Shay took one more look at her protector lying prone on the floor and shook her head. That planter has been there for months. What's so different about it today? She murmured as she trotted down the stairs. When Shay reached the bottom step, she hesitated. Tassie was seated at the round table in the back room, her gaze averted to the wooden planked floor. Jen's face was contorted in her best stern mother expression as she hovered over the girl. It was clear that Tassie had done something Jen, a mother of two, didn't approve of. What's up?
Are you going to tell her, or should I?
Tassie shook her head and looked up at Jen, then over at Shay. The whites of Tassie's gunmetal gray eyes were streaked with red, and her smudged charcoal eyeliner dripped down her cheeks. What's wrong? Asked Shay, hurrying to the girl's side.
She cut class, that's what's wrong, snapped Jen, crossing her arms over her heaving chest. If Joanne finds out about this, it will be the end of her working here, and do you want that?
She glared down at Tassie.
No, Tassie's bottom lip quivered. But I did go.
Then why are you here now?
Wait a second, Jen, let her explain. Something clearly happened, said Shay, pinning her gaze on Tassie's pale face. Is that right? Did something happen when you got to school? Tassie nodded, tears leaking from the corners of her eyes. Take your time. Shay sat next to Tassie and held the girl's hand. Just take a deep breath and tell us what upset you this morning.
I got to school and Spirit was sitting by the bike rack.
Like he was waiting for you? Asked Jen skeptically.
Yeah, it was weird. He's never done that before, but anyway, I looked at my bike and I heard Spirit growling behind me. I turned around to see what was going on and my dad was standing there.
Your dad? Said Shay in astonishment.
Your aunt's never mentioned him dropping by before,
said Jen doubtfully as she eyed Tassie.
He never has. I've barely heard from him since he and Mom got divorced. I always thought it was because he was mad at me for embarrassing him back home. You know, when I got into so much trouble at school and then with the police.
Yeah, which led you to coming to live here with your Aunt Joanne, right?
Said Jen, taking a seat at the table.
Yeah, so she could straighten me out, I guess, Tassie said, casting her gaze downward.
So, how do you think your aunt is going to react to you cutting school today?
I had to, though.
Tassie looked back up at Jen.
He was just standing there, grinning at me.
Jen opened her mouth, but Shay sent her a warning glance.
What did he want?
Shay asked encouragingly.
He wanted to introduce me to his girlfriend, and he insisted that he'd pick me up after school to take me out to dinner so she and I could properly get to know each other.
You're kidding.
Jen's usual pale blue eyes flashed sapphire.
He blindsided you at school when you were heading to class to introduce you to that woman?
Yeah, I guess, because there she was, sitting in his car, waving and smiling at me with those dark red puffy lips and fluttering her butterfly eyelashes like I'd be all happy to see her.
What did you say to her?
Shay asked, inwardly cringing at what Tassie might tell them next.
Nothing to her. When she started to open the door to get out, Spirit leapt at the side of the car and stood snarling at her through the window. She slammed it shut and stayed put.
Shay quietly let out a sigh of relief. Sometimes Tassie's 17-year-old internal filter was lacking, and she could often make a bad situation worse with an outburst. A lesson the girl was slowly learning, it appeared.
Then Dad yelled at me about controlling my dog. I told him that it wasn't my dog, but obviously he was protecting me from something. Dad blew a gasket and shouted that I didn't need protection from him or the woman who was going to be my new mother. I told him I already had a mother and didn't need a new one.
Good for you. I bet he couldn't say much after that, said Jen.
Nope, he did. After he stopped laughing, he said,
Cassie dropped her voice to mimic her father.
Yeah, you've got a great mother, don't you? She shipped you off to live with your aunt the first chance she got, and look at you with your crazy dyed hair. What are those? Rainbow streaks? I thought it was bad enough when you hacked it off and then bleached it white. Now you look like one of those little pony toys you played with as a kid. And what's this I hear about you working at that witch's store after school?
Shay dropped her mouth open in indignation, ready to give her 2 cents worth. But she took one look at the tears forming again in Tassie's eyes and quickly snapped it shut. Then he said,
Tassie's bottom lip quivered, and tears she'd been holding back streamed freely down her cheeks.
Well, I'll tell you, little missy. This is all going to stop. You'll be coming to live with me and Jasmine and have a proper family life from now on. Mark my words, Tassie, you haven't heard the end of this. You and that mother of yours, if you can call her that, will be hearing from my attorneys, and then I'll make sure you never set foot in this town again. You belong with me and Jasmine, and you'd better start getting to know her because, unlike you, she isn't going anywhere.
Shay and Jen gasped a collective breath. Spirit then silently meandered past Shay and rested his head on Tassie's lap, his sorrowful whimpering sending shivers up Shay's spine. Chapter 2. Shay closed the door into the back room behind her, glanced over to the sales counter, and gave Jen a weak smile.
How's Tassie doing?
Better, said Shay. She freshened up and is just finishing her tea before she comes out.
Good. As you can see, we don't have any customers yet, so while you were calming her down, I locked up and went across the street to Cup of Joe and told Joanne what happened.
Is she upset about Tassie cutting class?
Not at all. As a matter of fact, she completely understands and is going to call the school to tell them Tassie is having girl issues today.
Girl issues?
Yeah, they're less likely to ask many questions with an excuse like that. She feels it's up to her sister to fill them in on the details if she needs to. Anyway, she was giving Karen a call when I left to tell her about Peter's latest antics and find out what she wants her to do now.
It's just not fair to put Tassie in the middle like this. I would love to have 2 minutes alone with that man. Shay glanced over her sister's shoulder to see what she had in her hand. What's that?
These are the posters for the Fall Harvest Wine and Artisan Festival. Joanne gave me a couple, one for inside the shop and one to hang in the window.
Yikes. I forgot all about the festival coming up.
Are we going to have a table on the sidewalk again?
I can't see why not. Giving away tea samples at the town events seems to be the number one way we're gaining new customers.
Shay scanned the shelving units of gold-bagged, pre-made tea blends she had prepared.
But I can see a few busy evenings topping up our inventory between now and then if we're going to.
Jen's gaze followed her sister's to the half-empty shelves and she nodded.
Yeah, who'd have thought a year ago when we were struggling to make a name in this town as the premier tea shop and not the witch's weird store, that it would actually work and be such a success?
Oh, ye of little faith, laughed Shay. Jen shook her head.
It wasn't us I doubted. It was the people in Bray Harbor. You know, between the bizarre junk collection Bridget had stacked up in here for years and the dead body on the greenhouse roof, I really thought we'd never gain a foothold in the business community, and now we can't keep up with the demand.
I think the new decor has a lot to do with that.
Shay cast her gaze around the tea shop and smiled. Pride swelled in her chest at the work she and Jen had put into bringing the musty old space into the 21st century, with its linens and soft hues of green and cream, and the large potted plants around the room's perimeter that brought life back into the space.
Yeah, we've done good, sis. But don't discard all the other stuff Bridget used to do. It is the reason a lot of our customers come back.
I know your afternoon tea leaf readings have been a hit. I only wish I knew more about all the stuff I read about in Bridget's journals, like how to read crystals and palms, to learn just by looking at someone what ails them and then finding the right tea solution to ease their ailments. I've only touched the surface of what we could be offering our customers. I thought you could already do that, you know, with those inky feelings you get.
I can to a certain extent tell when something is wrong, but I want to be able to look at someone and just know what it is instead of just sensing they have an issue or ailment.
I thought you wanted nothing to do with all that other stuff.
I don't. Well, not really. But the more I read in Bridget's journals, the more intrigued I am, and it makes me wonder if perhaps there is more to it than I thought.
What about Madame Malvina? You've been spending a lot of time with her. Hasn't she been some help with all the other woo-woo stuff?
It's not woo-woo. It's about learning to get in touch with and channeling energy.
Is that what she told you?
No, that's the conclusion I've made on my own.
You mean she hasn't been dispensing any pearls of wisdom during her visits?
Not really.
Then ask yourself, why not? Could it be because she's afraid you'll steal her secrets? After all, you are her only competition in the area.
Shay shrugged, recalling how evasive Madame Malvina had been the last time she popped in for one of her flyby visits. Jen might be more right than she knew.
Shay already suspected that Madame Malvina's visits were actually recon missions to see how far Shay had come with her lessons in Bridget's journals, and if Shay's abilities were a threat to the woman who proclaimed to be the best and only real psychic on the Monterey Peninsula. If Malvina only knew that Shay had no intention of making that claim, she was not, as far as she was concerned, despite the inky feelings, as Jen had called them, a psychic. She was a scientist, originally trained as a geologist, which had ignited her love of gemstones and eventually led her to establishing her high-end jewelry design shop in New Mexico. That was, until it was stolen out from under her. She took a deep breath, pushed the image of her ex's betrayal from her mind, repeated her mantra. When things fall apart, better things fall into place. And reminded herself that any results Bridget had produced with her healing herbs and readings had a plausible, scientific explanation. As a scientist, that's what she was interested in studying and evaluating.
I think her visits have more to do with her son Orion wanting to spend time with Tassie. They seem to be kindred spirits, don't you think? Said Shay.
I don't know. I don't trust the woman. I think everything about her is phony, and I wouldn't put it past her to be using Orion's feelings for Tassie as an excuse to keep tabs on you.
Maybe. But she was a big help in identifying the toxic plants upstairs that, if used incorrectly, could kill one of our customers. She swallowed. Or us.
Yeah, but that's all she said. Then she left it up to you to figure it out. All I can say is thank goodness for Mia and her training.
Speaking of Mia, I should give her a call to find out when she's sending her students by to pick up those plans for the college. The longer they stay upstairs, the longer I worry about having them around here. And Spirit's behavior this morning really has me on edge right now.
What do you mean, the way he was behaving? Was it weirder than usual?
I thought so. Shay then replayed the dog's actions regarding the planter that morning after Jen went downstairs to check on Tassie. And she involuntarily shivered with the image. So you see, something has changed with those plants. I was about to inspect them to see if they were causing the edginess I'm feeling. But then he showed up and his action sent my senses on high alert. And then the crisis with Tassie erupted and, well... said Jen, as she taped a festival poster on the glass door.
We're not busy yet. Maybe you should take a few minutes and run upstairs to check it out. Who knows? Perhaps one of them has flowered and the fragrance is deadly?
According to Mia, Henbane and Angel's Trumpet are guilty of that, but I don't have any growing upstairs, thankfully.
Are they the only ones that even if you smell them, they can make you sick? You said yourself that you have a lot of creepy stuff up there, according to Madame Malvina.
They're the only ones both her and Mia warned me about. Shay shook her head. Although, if some of the flowers on the other ones are ingested, they are deadly. But as far as just smelling them, no, I don't think so.
Well, as you said, something is bothering Spirit today. It wouldn't hurt to check it out now that things with Tassie have settled down.
Did I hear my name? Asked Tassie, coming out of the back room. Did Auntie have a fit about me cutting class? Her eyes widened. Is she going to send me to live with that horrible woman?
No, not at all, cried Jen, rushing to her side. Joanne completely understands. She's even going to call the high school and excuse your absence.
Jen rubbed her hands up and down Tassie's arms while the girl's shoulders shook.
Don't you worry. She and your mom will make sure his threat is just that, and nothing comes out of it.
Tassie nodded and sniffled as she glanced toward the window. A low gasp left her chest, and she pointed.
Then what's he doing at Cup of Joe now?
Shay swung around to look just as Spirit bounded out of the back room, raced across the tea room, and leapt at the door, planting his front paws on the glass. His lips pulled back in a snarl.
Spirit, down, commanded Shay.
The hulking canine sat back on his haunches, turned his crystal blue eyes on her, and let out a gruff whine, showing his disapproval.
I know, Shay whispered, joining him at the door.
You'd like nothing better than to bolt out of here, snarling and snapping, to chase that man down the street in order to protect Tassie, but... She patted his head.
We have to be smart about this, or we'll end up losing her for sure.
Spirit let out a low, whining whimper.
Shay cringed when a well-groomed, salt-and-pepper-haired man she assumed was Tassie's dad, Peter, took a step toward Joanne and wagged his finger in her face. She slapped his hand away, and after planting her feet, she leaned into him and shouted something to his face so forcefully her bobbed dark hair quivered. He flung his arms up, spun on his heel, and took a step toward the main sidewalk. But Joanne grabbed his arm and spun him back toward her. Clearly caught off guard by the feisty woman's actions, he stumbled into one of the street-side patio tables and his face turned beet red.
Tassie?
Shay called nonchalantly, hoping her voice did not indicate her panic over the situation she was watching go down.
Jen and I were just talking about preparing for the Fall Harvest Wine and Artisan Festival and how we need to top up our inventory.
She glanced over her shoulder to where Tassie and Jen stood by the backroom door.
Since you're going to be here today, perhaps you could get a start on gathering some of the plants we're going to need to dry.
The list of blends we make regularly is in the file folder upstairs on my desk. Tassie started toward Shay. Shay gave a slight shake of her head and hoped her eyes telegraphed, "Don't let her come over here," to Jen.
"I'll help you look for the list, and we can get started on harvesting," said Jen, grabbing Tassie's hand before she got too close to the window. "Come on, it'll be fun."
Tassie craned her neck to try to get a better look past Shay,
but Shay did a little bop and hop in the hope of blocking her view of the scene playing out across the street.
"Now that does sound like fun," Shay said.
"I join you, but someone has to look after the shop while you guys play in the dirt," Shay added with a laugh that she hoped came off as sincere.
Tassie's shoulders dropped when Shay bounced to the spot Tassie had been trying to see out through.
"Are you okay? I've never seen you so jittery. Is my dad causing a scene over there?"
"No, not at all. Joe has everything under control.
I'm fine. I'm, just excited by the prospect of your teaching Jen how to harvest the chamomile flowers and mint leaves."
"Okay," said Tassie, an edge of skepticism in her voice.
She eyed Shay and attempted once more to see out the window, but Shay blocked her view again.
"Since I'm here, why not? But if it gets busy, call us so we can wait on tables."
"I will for sure.
Best to take Spirit with you too, though. Sometimes some of the customers are intimidated by his presence."
Tassie took another questioning look at Shay, slightly shook her head, showing her skepticism, and retreated into the back room. Jen stared blankly at her sister and whispered,
"What's up?"
"Look."
Shay gestured toward the heated scene still playing out across the road. I couldn't let her see her Aunt Jo and her dad going at it like two cats on a fence. Jen scowled and then winced. And I'd say it's about to get worse. Look, that woman he's dating just got out of his car and she's heading over here. Shay spun back toward the window in time to see the woman she presumed was Jasmine tottering on her spike heels across the cobblestone surface of High Street toward the tea shop.
Great. Just what we need.
I'll make sure Tassie's kept busy upstairs. You take care of that, Jen said as she disappeared through the backroom doorway.
Gee, thanks, grumbled Shay.
Chapter 3. Shay plastered a smile on her face as the overhead doorbells tinkled.
Good morning, may I help you?
She pinned the woman who was destined to be Tassie's stepmother, or so it seemed, with the sweetest smile she could muster. The woman shoved her sunglasses up onto her head and scoped out the shop.
This isn't what I expected at all by the signs on the window. It's rather nice in here.
What exactly were you expecting? Asked Shay, knowing her question came out a little more biting than she intended.
I mean, where's all the witch stuff Peter told me about? You know, the cats, cauldrons, and the skull candle holders.
The woman visibly shivered.
You know, the witchy stuff.
She flipped her head back, sending her long dark hair cascading over her shoulders and continued to scan the shop.
It's just...
She shrugged her slender shoulders.
Normal in here. The green napkins and cream tablecloths even complement the window curtains and all those plants.
She waved her hand about.
I really can't see what all the fuss is about.
Fuss? I'm sorry, you are? Shay fixed what she hoped was a naive expression on her face.
I'm Jasmine Massey, Peter Graham's girlfriend. You know, Tassie's dad. He told me all about it and the goings-on in here.
I see. Shay nodded, pensively replaying Jasmine's words. That's funny, though, because I don't recall him ever being a customer or even coming into the tea shop.
He's heard stories, I guess. And he said he was worried about his little girl getting involved with witches and magic and all that stuff.
She glanced around again.
But it looks normal to me.
She paused when her gaze settled on the closed door leading into the back room.
That is, unless you have the other stuff back there.
She said excitedly and took a step forward. No, said Shay, bounding in front of the woman to block her path. The last thing Shay needed was for this woman to see the hundreds of crystal pendants hanging from the ceiling. That's off limits to customers. It's the kitchen. We can't let people wander in and out. Health code and all that. You understand.
Right. Of course.
Jasmine looked down her perfectly refined nose, glanced back at the window, then locked her gaze on Shay.
Do you offer any of the services you advertise on there? Or is that a scam to get people like me to come in?
It's not a scam, I assure you.
Okay. Then I want you to read my tea leaves and my aura. Where should I sit?
Yikes. This was the last thing Shay wanted to do. Reading the woman's aura was not an issue. The energy surrounding her was flashing an array of neon colors, everything from red to orange to yellow and even black. However, Shay knew if she didn't get the woman out of her shop now, Peter could well storm through the door any minute, looking for her. And then the shop would be filled with a dark energy for sure, especially if Tassie happened to come downstairs.
As much as I would love to,
cooed Shay apologetically. She hoped.
I'm afraid I'm completely booked up for the day.
That wasn't exactly a fib. She did have a tea leaf reading on her schedule for later that afternoon.
Jasmine raised her perfectly waxed brows and glanced around the empty shop.
As a matter of fact, my first client is here now.
Shay smiled and waved at Zoe Lane, a local veterinarian and the girlfriend of Liam Madigan, the owner of the pub next door to Shay's tea shop, when the overhead bells tinkled out their greeting.
Zoe, you're just in time. Take a seat and we'll get started on your reading right away.
Zoe tucked her sunglasses up against her jet black hair, which was piled in a high messy bun, and stared vacantly at Shay.
Do you want chamomile for your reading today, or should we be a bit bolder and play it by ear?
Shay fleetingly glanced at Jasmine, then locked her gaze on Zoe's. Zoe's gaze darted to Jasmine, and a flash of comprehension filled her eyes.
Sure, let's play it by ear. What do you suggest?
She said, taking a seat at the table closest to the door. Jasmine pursed her noticeably enhanced ruby lips and gave Zoe a quick once-over, her expression showing great disdain for Zoe's natural striking beauty, enhanced by her exotic olive skin tone. She huffed again, tugged at the hem of her miniskirt, shouldered her diminutive handbag, and looked back at Shay.
I still want a reading.
Sorry, as I said, I'm all booked up today.
Shay motioned to the door.
But if you're ever going to be back this way again, you can call ahead and book an appointment. Bye now, it's been lovely meeting you.
Shay opened the door just as Peter stormed out of Cuppa Joe's street side patio and marched across the street toward them. Shay glanced back at Jasmine, still lingering in the spot where she'd been standing.
Really, you'll have to go. Now.
Jasmine wiggled her body in indignation, harumphed, and sauntered toward the door Shay held open for her.
I'll be in town for at least a week, she said over her shoulder as she saw Shade past Shay. Peter has some business to look after, so if you get an opening in your schedule, we're staying at the fancy hotel on the beach.
She tossed her mane of hair just as Shay closed the door behind her, but not before Shay heard Peter bellow,
Where is she?
He stepped onto the curb in front of the tea shop and glared down at Jasmine.
Where's my daughter? Is she in there?
Jasmine shook her head and said something to him as she ushered him back across the road toward their car. Shay laid her forehead on the glass of the door and slowly let out a pent-up breath.
That was entertaining.
Zoe chuckled and stood beside Shay.
Yeah, I bet it was.
Mind telling me what it was all about? Or shouldn't I ask?
That was Tassie's father's girlfriend, and Tassie had an altercation at the school with them this morning. She's upstairs now with Jen and seems to have calmed down, but I was afraid she might walk in when Jasmine was here and everything would be set off again.
What did you just say her name is?
Asked Zoe, peering out the door.
Jasmine. Jasmine Massey. Why?
It's just that she looked so familiar.
Her gaze focused on the two getting into the car across the street.
No,
she shrugged.
I don't know the name, though.
Hey, thanks for going along with my little ploy to get her out of here.
A mischievous glint flashed in Zoe's forest green eyes.
What?
Perhaps you could return the favor?
Okay.
Shay eyed her guardedly.
What can I do for you?
She hoped that the favor was something simple, like a neighbor wanting to borrow a cup of sugar or even her lawnmower. Since Zoe had made the big step to move into Liam's Crystal Beach cottage a few months ago and put her own condo up for sale, Zoe had taken Shay's neighborly hospitality to the max already and was always asking for a favor. Shortly after she'd moved in, Liam had received a call that his grandfather in Ireland had passed away. Since Liam's own father had passed a couple of years ago, he was the last close family member. It was only right that Liam go and help his gran take care of business and personal matters. That left Zoe on her own in her new home and in her new surroundings with most of her furniture in storage. According to what she told Shay then, she wanted to make sure the living arrangement would work before she downsized anymore and was keeping her options open.
Shay liked Zoe. She was practical, intelligent, friendly, and until Liam had gone away, she had seemed a fiercely independent woman. But with Liam's departure, something had changed. Since Shay's cottage was across the lane from Liam's, Zoe had become somewhat of a permanent fixture on Shay's doorstep most evenings, and most days too, as she'd drop into the tea shop for a quick chat before or after work. However, the gleam in Zoe's eyes and the sparks of energy that zinged through the air around her told Shay this might be more than her neighbor wanting to borrow a cup of sugar.
I need you to do a reading for me now. It's important.
Right now?
Shay asked, glancing at the clock on the wall behind the back sales counter. It was almost 10, and her usual morning tea group would be arriving shortly. They were the most punctual group of customers she'd ever had, and they converged at the tea shop for tea around 10. They'd have their visit and then leave just as Shay's lunch hour rush began at noon. It was perfect, and Shay couldn't be happier that the group had selected her tea shop as their daily meeting place, since the group consisted of over a dozen ladies who were on the who's who's list of Bray Harbor's most influential people.
When I said now, I meant today.
Zoe glanced at her watch.
I have to do surgery on a pet pig in half an hour, and then this afternoon I'm doing my biweekly shift at the animal shelter. But I can drop by after that if that's okay.
Her eyes darkened as she implored Shay. Shay sorted through the mental card catalog of her schedule. Her mind flashed to the plant table upstairs and the image of Spirit lying beside it. The amulet around her neck once again warmed against her skin.
Today might not. Please,
Zoe said, holding her hands in a prayer pose.
It's really important. Remember I told you the other day that because Liam's family pub had sold, he was packing up Gran's personal effects and flying back with her to San Francisco later this week so he could get her settled in with his mom?
Shay nodded, recalling how Zoe had talked relentlessly about Liam's finally coming home. News that made Shay's heart do a little flutter, if she was being completely honest with herself. Not that she harbored any real romantic feelings for Liam, but she had to admit she did miss that impish grin of his and how his electric blue eyes sparkled when he teased her. More importantly, she missed him because he was one of the few people in the world she could talk to about their experiences last year and how that shared experience had bonded them together as friends and, in his words, made them kin as both their ancestors were from County Clare in Ireland. But still, this didn't stop her from daydreaming from time to time about what could be.
Well,
Zoe said breathlessly.
He phoned me this morning and told me he has a big life-changing surprise for me when he gets back this week.
She squealed with excitement.
So, you see, I just have to have a reading done now.
A life-changing surprise, you say? Shay quirked a brow as another daydream bubble burst right before her eyes. Chapter 4. Shay glanced up at the wall clock, scanned the street view outside one bay window, then the other one, then checked the time again.
Relax,
said Jen as she arranged the tray of Scottish scones that Muriel Sykes, the owner of the Muffin Top Bakery, had dropped off earlier as part of her regular morning delivery.
They're just running late. I'm sure it's not easy to wrangle over a dozen ladies together and have them all arrive at a precise time and location.
But it's well past 10, and every day this month they have been here within a few minutes of each other. I'm just afraid that we're not their favorite cafe anymore. You do the books. You know that they're coming in Monday through Friday also brings a lot of wannabes who are hoping to be invited to join their prestigious group, and it's really boosted our daily sales.
Did you say prestigious group?
Jen stifled a chuckle.
Is that what you call a bunch of ladies who traipse around town wearing little white gloves and having tea and scones 5 days a week?
Gentry ladies, perhaps? Is that a better description?
I guess, if you think donning dainty white gloves and paying homage to the 1950s is that, then yes.
Don't be so hard on them, Jen. You know full well that they do that so they can help recapture more peaceful, gentler time in history than what's been happening in this day and age.
I guess, said Jen, covering the tray with a sheet of cling wrap.
Be careful, mocked Shay, going to the window and scanning the street in both directions. It's starting to sound like you're a little jealous that you, the sheriff's wife, weren't invited to join the group and Julia Fisher was. Shay heard her sister's exasperated purge of breath behind her and turned. You have to admit that your constant comments of disapproval for the group are beginning to sound a lot like resentment or jealousy.
You have to admit, though, that the reasons for my disapproval are exactly why the Little White Glove Society isn't the prestigious group they think they are. If they can allow a double-crossing, crooked real estate agent to be a member and not me, then it just goes to show they actually have no class at all.
Jen flashed Shay a smug smile, spun on her heel, and disappeared into the back room with the tray of goodies. While you're back there, can you go upstairs and check on Tassie and see how she's managing? Called Shay. She no sooner got the request out when a loud crash resounded through the second floor. Shay dashed to the back room and found Jen already halfway up the spiral staircase. With two long, bounding steps, Shay was right behind her sister when a series of animatedly uttered curse words drifted down toward them.
Tassie! Hollered Jen. Unless you're lying in a pool of blood, there's no excuse for that kind of language.
She reached the top, looped around the handrail, and stopped short. Shay popped up behind her sister and did a quick assessment of the scene before them. The large potted rosary bean plant, which had been isolated on the table with the other highly poisonous plants, was lying on the brick floor in a heap of dislodged earth, and its pot lay in shards around it.
What happened?
Him.
Tassie pointed at Spirit.
That's what happened.
Shay glanced at the hulking white dog standing between Tassie and the mess on the floor.
I don't understand. I was gathering the mint leaves from this table.
She pointed to the planting box directly behind the roped-off table labeled poison.
I'd just laid my gloves and pruning shears down on the edge of the poison table so I could collect the leaves I'd snipped off, and he started yipping at me. I couldn't figure out what the problem was, but then he leapt up from where he'd been lying in front of that table, planted his front paws on my shoulders, and I stumbled back and slammed into the table.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.